Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining how to configure an explicit path for a TE tunnel in an MPLS-TE topology. I believe learning telecom and networking should be simple and accessible to everyone. That's why I take complex topics and explain them in a way that makes sense. If you find value in this, don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon to stay updated. In our quest to understand MPLS-TE, we've gone over several different topics, including the establishment of TE tunnels and methods for routing traffic down those tunnels. What we haven't focused on very much yet is the specific path that these tunnels take through the topology. A tunnel that's configured with a dynamic path option and no constraints at all will simply follow the same path as the route determined by the underlying IGP. We've tweaked this a bit by modifying the TE metric, thus differentiating the path the tunnel will take from regular traffic. But the major value and the primary benefit that we get from MPLS-TE is the fact that we can create traffic engineering tunnels through our MPLS topology that can be manipulated in a wide variety of ways, thus enabling very granular control over the actual path that those tunnels take through our topology. Unlike packet routing, TE tunnels can continually be directed and redirected through the MPLS-TE topology based on constraints and parameters, many of which we have not yet examined. So this tunnel here may take this path, then it may take this path, and then it may go back to taking this path again. And this may change over time dynamically, depending upon the needs and limitations of the traffic being served by that tunnel. In this video, we'll be taking a look at one of the ways in which we can manipulate a tunnel to take a particular path. And specifically, we'll see how to do this using the explicit path configuration. Now, when we talk about explicit paths, what we are actually doing is defining which routers and/or interfaces the tunnel should use or avoid. Now, this is our topology. If you want to refresh your memory on what has been configured up to now, take a look at some of the previous videos in our MPLS playlist. Here's a quick review. We've configured the OSPF underlay, we've configured MPLS-TE, we've configured RSVP-TE, and we've established our unidirectional LSP tunnel from PE1, the head-end router, to PE2, which is the tail-end router. At this point, this is the configuration that we've already applied to our tunnel. We have configured the dynamic path option here, which means the tunnel will use the TE metric of the underlying OSPF-TE IGP. We have no routing configured at this point for the tunnel, since what we want to examine today is the actual path of the tunnel, not the routing of traffic through it. Let's take a look at the default path the tunnel takes. Now, using this command, we can see various pieces of information about the tunnel. Here we see two specific lists of IP addresses that show us the route this tunnel takes. We can see the RSVP information here, and we see the IP addresses of the interfaces through which the tunnel is established. Similarly, we see the underlying IGP that has been configured and the path that it has chosen based on the traffic engineering metric that has been assigned to that path by the OSPF-TE protocol. So the tunnel, according to this, is physically routed through P1 and P2. We see that these two paths match, as expected, because by default, a tunnel will follow the TE metric determined by the underlying IGP. Now, to configure the explicit paths feature, there are several things we can constrain. We can include or exclude the router ID of the router we want to pass through or avoid. Or we can include or exclude the IP addresses of interfaces we want to pass through or avoid. Whether we use the router ID or a specific interface address, the command is the same. Let's start by attempting to exclude the P1 router from our tunnel path. To do this, we configure the following on our PE1 router, which is our head-end router. Remember, all of these configurations are applied to the head-end router only. Now, we must create a construct that is called an explicit path, and we'll name it and then enable it. Let's name it P1 P1_exclude. Once we issue this command, we enter into the explicit path configuration mode. Using the context-sensitive help, we can see the options that are made available to us. For including interface addresses or router IDs, we use the next address keyword. For excluding interface addresses or router IDs, we use the exclude address option. Since at this point we want to exclude P1 from the path, we'll use the exclude address option. Now to exclude the P1 router, we issue the command in the explicit path configuration mode. When we issue this command, we define the 1.1.1.1 address, which is our router ID for P1, as the address that belongs to our explicit path entity named P1 exclude. Next, we have to apply this explicit path to the tunnel. We enter our tunnel configuration mode, and at this point, we use our context-sensitive help to see the various path options that are given to us. We see the dynamic and explicit options. Before, we had configured the dynamic option, but now we want to choose the explicit option. This configuration will overwrite the previous dynamic configuration we had applied. So we choose explicit, and then we specify the name of our explicit path entity that we created, which is our P1_exclude. The result of this configuration is that the tunnel should avoid the P1 router. And since it only has one other choice of path, it should go via this path here. Now let's check the path that our tunnel has indeed taken. Here, using the RSVP path info, you can see the tunnel no longer goes through this path here because P1 is excluded. We now have an explicit route that goes this way. And this is verified by the IP addresses in our RSVP explicit path list. The interesting thing, however, is that the IGP path that uses the TE metric remains the same. The TE metric hasn't changed, but the tunnel is simply instructed to avoid using this particular router. So we've successfully configured an explicit path to exclude a particular router. Remember, you can issue the same command and instead of a router ID, use the IP address of any interface you may want to avoid. Now let's attempt to include a particular interface. Let's first remove our exclusion configuration from our topology. So the tunnel has now returned to its original path. Now let's say that we want to include the gigabit Ethernet 07 interface of the P4 router here, which has an IP address of 10.10.70.1. Now to do this, we issue the following commands, once again on our headend router PE1. We create our explicit path entity, and this time we'll name it P4GI07_include. And this time we'll use the next address keyword. This keyword essentially says that we want one of the next addresses in the path to include the IP address we specify. But this configuration option requires an additional parameter. We must specify either strict or loose operation. Now, what do these mean? Well, loose means that the next address we specify should be one of the next addresses in our path. Strict means that the next address we specify should be the very next address in our explicit path. In other words, strict means that the IP address we specify should be directly connected. Now, since the interface address we're specifying is several hops away, we won't use the strict option. We'll use the loose option. So we specify loose and we also specify the IP address we want to include in the path. Next, we apply the explicit path we created to our tunnel using this command here. This should result in the path going through this interface we specified. Now let's take a look. Here we can see our explicit route goes through the specified interface as expected. But once again, our TE metric, as well as the path specified by the underlying IGP, remain unchanged. Now this example shows how explicit including and excluding can change the path that the tunnel takes. For a small topology like this, this may seem inconsequential, since we only have two possible paths through which the tunnel can be routed. But for large networks with dozens or hundreds of routers, being able to cause a multitude of tunnels to explicitly go through or avoid specific routers or interfaces can be very beneficial. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment below. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.